sin dating to become acceptable. You know, sometimes I hear somebody say, not my father, father is being political, meaning he doesn't want to come out straight. For instance, in America now, you cannot say homosexuality is bad, even though the Bible condemns it, isn't it? You will not say it's bad. If you say that, you are not politically correct, and people don't want to be politically incorrect. You know, that's why many churches do not preach against it. Or they ask you a question, what do you think about homosexuals? Or what do you think about homosexuality? They are human beings created by God. They are like us. They too have souls. Some of them are good. They can. Is that the answer? What are you doing? You are being what? Meaning that you are not telling the truth. When you see somebody going to tell you, now forget that guy. That guy is a politician. Forget him. Does not necessarily mean that the guy is holding one political post or the other. It is just our colloquial way of saying that that guy is not honest. He's not straightforward. Now, the biggest problem is that even we, priests, pastors, men and women of God, have become like the little child who picks up the apple in one hand, the money in the other hand, and sits on top of the Bible. That many men of God, many priests of God, have become politicians in quotes. Meaning that they put personal interests, monetary interests, material interests, above the truth, above the word of God, and they sit on the truth. That is the worrisome thing. That is one of the sins of my generation. So on behalf of the priests and the pastors who do the same, I'm asking for your forgiveness. Forgive us. Just pray for all sinners now and at the hour of our death. Now, this is exactly what happened between Amos in the first reading and Amaziah. In those days, Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, said to Amos, "O seer, go, flee away to the land of Judah and eat bread there and prophesy there and earn your living there." Amaziah was the official prophet or priest in Bethel. Bethel was regarded as the place where the king, Bethlehem, where the king stayed in Judah. Amaziah came from Israel. Israel is the northern kingdom. Judah is the southern kingdom. And the southern kingdom was where the king were regarded, where the king stayed. So Amos came to where Amaziah was, and Amaziah said to him, "No, you cannot prophesy here. Go back to where you are coming from. Do your prophecy there and end your living." In other words, they have turned prophecy or the office of the prophethood as an occupation. What you do to earn a living, to get money. So the presence of Amos was going to be like a competition for his bread or money. You know, politicians don't like competition, three of us. I hear now. Politicians don't like competition. They don't like rivalry, three of us. You know now, you don't expect me to tell you. So Amaziah, if you want to call him the political prophet, was getting threatened by the presence of Amos. I told him, "This is where I earn my own bread. This is where I carry out my own work. Why don't you go back to where you're coming from? Go and establish your own prophetic shop there." Praise God. Are you following me? Raise your hand like this. Are you following me? Now, that's why I asked you, what's the difference between occupation and vocation? Is the priesthood, is the ministry a vocation or an occupation? Or what should it be? Should it be an occupation or a vocation? It should be a vocation. And a vocation is what? A call. as Emma said, he said, listen, I am not even interested in what you're saying. I was not a prophet. I was not born a prophet. I was not trained a prophet. I am a herdsman. I dress sycamore. That means I had my own job before God took me and brought me here. So don't think I'm happy being here. I have the job I am doing. In other words, I have my own occupation before he handed over this vocation to me. For lack of time, let us just take some little differences between occupation and vocation, and then we finish. But the title of my reflection today is The Occupation of Your Vocation. We are coming to that now. A vocation, an occupation is what you do for a living, but a vocation is what you live for. There is a difference between the two. An occupation is what you do for a living, but your vocation is what you live for. There's a difference between, just like there's a difference between eating to live and living to eat. Which one are we supposed to do? Some are confused. And these are the ones who live to eat. What are we supposed to do? Are we supposed to be living to eat, or are we supposed to be eating to live? Eating to live. Meaning that we do not live for food. Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. So your occupation is what you do for a living, but your vocation is what you live for. Your occupation can be a lawyer. You do it so that you earn a living, you earn money. But you do not live for money. Those who live for money are the lawyers that will see a criminal, a murderous criminal, and take money and defend the person in court and turn this judgment, the situation around. That person is not, the person is living for what? For money. Your occupation is your choice. You choose your occupation. But your vocation is God's choice. Hello? Say amen, say amen.
Amen.
Your occupation is your choice. You choose what you become. That's one of the reasons I even told you that story. Listen, your occupation is your choice. Sometimes there are some parents who ask, or there are some Christians who ask a man of God what their child will be in future. Some are praying and fasting for God to reveal to them what their child will be in future. There are some who believe they were destined to be engineers, so if they are not engineers, they will never make it in life. Actually, some have gone to churches where they are told that the reason you are experiencing frustration as a teacher is because God destined you to be a medical doctor and you became a teacher. Some people have heard that kind of thing. There is nothing like that. It's a lie. Nobody was created a doctor. You become a doctor by training. It is your choice. If you're understanding me, wave your hand like this. Praise God. Wave your hand like this if you're understanding me. Your occupation is your choice. God gives you the opportunity, the ability, the capacity. It is not left for you to choose what to do with all of those incentives. When God created us, it is not that if I wanted, I could have become a medical doctor by choice if I did not have the call to the priesthood. Similar thing plays out in marriage. There are many couples that have problems in their marriages and they go to a certain man of God to see. Those of you who keep going to people to see for you, keep going, they will keep seeing. The problem is that they will be seeing, but you will not see. And once you don't see, you are blind. You cannot see with another person's eye. Is it possible? Any little thing you want to go and see so that somebody will see for you. You have a problem with your wife, you go and this man of God tells you that this person is not your wife. You married another person's wife. What kind of rubbish is that? Father, the problem is because a man of God told me, and it's true, Father, yes, there was a man who was coming to me for marriage those days. In fact, Father, there are three different men coming. I don't even know why I fell for this man. It is now I realize I married another person's husband. So what is the next thing? Oh, Father, I'm going to go search for my own husband. And this man, somebody you wedded with in the church. Instead of taking responsibility for the things you are not doing well in your marriage, you want to abdicate and run. There are certain things God has placed in your hand. To be a lawyer or a doctor or to marry to this person or that person is not a destiny. It's your choice. Let me tell your neighbor, it's your choice. It's your choice. And you also decide how that marriage is going to be. Stop listening to rubbish. Some of God is telling you that when God created a man, he created a wife, the particular person that that man will marry. So if you don't marry that particular person God created for you, and you marry another person, your marriage will never be okay. And many of you carry these things in your head. That's why today when some girls want to marry, they will meet one man of God that sees and says, please look for me. Somebody is coming to her for marriage. She will come. You know, many come to us. Father, please, can you check, look for me whether this is the man God destined for me to marry? Father, look, look. As if I kept one mirror in my house where I look at people. I'm not looking. I know they look that kind of thing. I know they see. Or some will give you three names. Father, please decide which one God wants me to choose. Because there are actually men of God, so-called men of God, who prescribe for ladies and men who their wives will be and who their husbands will be. They tell you that God created one woman for you, one man for you. So that means that the woman God created for me, now she's going to die husbandless, Abby. If you understand what I'm saying, wave like this. Praise God. Praise God. And this is what happens when you abdicate your responsibility, hand over your life to somebody else in the name of stupid piety that makes no sense. Your occupation is your choice. It's not a destiny. It is your choice. God can give you the grace. He has given everybody the grace to do that. But your vocation is God's choice for you. You don't choose your vocation chooses you. It's part of the problem in our world is that many of us chose to be in vocation. There are many people who chose to be priests. There are many people who chose to be pastors. There are many people who chose to be evangelists. And you see it in their actions. They are doing their things. They are the center. No. The other way around, it is called call. If you are not called, you cannot answer. Your vocation is God's choice. The motivation in occupation is money, material interest. Yes, it is right. The reason you work is to earn money, true of us. So the greatest motivation in occupation is material benefit. And that's why it is wrong for anybody to owe anybody who has done work for you, whom you are supposed to pay. Somebody will come and do work for you. When it is time to pay for the person, you begin to speak grammar and begin to quote Bible for the person. That is not right. Pay. Whenever somebody does any work for you, pay. So the biggest motivation in occupation is material benefit. But in vocation, it is not. It is the will of God. It is the will of God. So the sin of my generation, of men and women of God, is that we make money and material benefits the primary motivation for the things we do. That's why you can see all kinds of crazy things happening in the name of churches. Money is at the root of it all. And this is the reason why in the gospel that Jesus told his disciples, can somebody give me a bulletin? I don't want to climb up there again. Look at the gospel. Vocation. Money is not the primary motivation or consideration. It is the will of God. He said to the apostles, And he gave them authority over unclean spirits. He charged them to take nothing for the journey. Take what? Nothing for their journey except a staff. No bread, no bank, no money in their belt. But to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. Why? He's telling them, you should not put your self-interest. Don't mind about yourself. Don't consider yourself. Take nothing. That is a vocation. You see, I am talking to you now. Many of you are not guilty, but many of us priests and so-called men of God, we are guilty of this. Money becomes so that when some ministers do not envisage some monetary gain, when they don't see any monetary gain in any spiritual function, they are either going to do it haphazardly or they will not do it at all. That is why you will not see many of these flourishing ministries in town. You can never find them in villages. You can't find them in villages. They can only preach Jesus Christ. Have you given your life to Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? You can only find them in Gariki, Metama, Asokoro, Wuse, Kubwa. You can't find them in Igu. You can't find them in Keti. You cannot find them in rural places because nobody will pay tithes there. The only churches you see there are our own church. That's why I'm proud to be a Catholic priest. And I've been in such places. You will find them there. Who is going to pay a tithe of 500,000? Who is going to give them money to appear on televisions and be like superstars? You won't. Unfortunately, some of us priests are copying some of these ideas. So much so that some Cali priests are measuring their priesthood by how much collection comes in their church. So that when a priest is posted to CKC Kubwa, he will do 9 days novena of thanksgiving to God. But when he's posted to Tunga Maji, he will do novena to Our Lady of Sorrows. Pray for us sinners. You call some priest to go for sequel for where? But to come and bless a shop or a car. Hey, wait for me, I'm coming, let us go. Actually, I was told a story I read of a billionaire, but this is on a white man country, happened not in Nigeria. A billionaire, Lord, his dog died. You know, some people are so attached to their pets. His dog died and he approached the priest and said, Father, please, I want to do funeral mass. I want you to do funeral mass for my dog. And the priest said, no, you can't do that. You don't do funeral for animals. And the man brought out a check. He said, Father, actually, this is a check of $1 million to book the mass. And Father scratched his head and said, but why didn't you tell me that the dog was a Catholic in the first place? The church calls it simony, the sin of simony, when money becomes the reason for what you do and for what you don't do. Some will not do it when there is no money in it. Some can only do when there is money in it. We are guilty too, even in the Catholic Church, we are in many ways. And it is wrong because in vocation, material blessings or material profit is not the first consideration. It is an addition. Are you following me? Let me finish with us first before I come to you. Your own sins are bigger than our own. So in Luke chapter 6, Jesus said, you cannot serve two masters. You either hate one and love the other. He said, no one can be the slave of both God and money. I am telling you, forget that their ministries are growing. Yes, even you can even see the manifestation of this latent drive by money in ministry. There are some priests, even in Catholic Church now, who have their oils. Go to our shops and you will see oil. Oil has different brands. You have St. Michael, or you have Back to Sender.
you have anointing, oil for prosperity. Which other one did I say? I'm sure. I think there is oil for catching your life partner before he escapes.
I'm going to make an official pronouncement on all of that, but let me just tell you now. The only oil, of course, you've been told, the church blesses you. There is only oil three that are blessed. Oil of the sick, the catechumen, and chrism. The other ones you can take as sacramental is by your faith. And that is normal oil. Have you heard of Goya oil? These are oils you can use to cook. What makes them holy is the blessing of the priest. So when somebody brands another oil and calls it a Michael oil, that is for commercial purpose. Because once some of you see Archangel Michael, the picture on the oil, him on top of the devil, how can you not buy? Advertisements. Then certain priests are not having their oil. For what? Why? What do you think is motivating that? But you are the ones buying. Hey, they will say, after all, you are a priest. Praise God. Money is not, material things in vocation is not the driving force. And how you know who an authentic minister is, remove monetary consideration and see how many will go. Like I told you, all these powerful men of God who are vibrating, let them go to a place like Igu or Keti. Let them go and work there. Then we shall know that they have anointing. Some of them, the anointing is only on television when you have thousands of crowds. But when they enter the village where you see only people suffering and all that, you will not see one manifestation of anointing. Stop encouraging such people. Praise God. If you are following me, your hand up. Wake up. So, now, all of us have our occupations, and all of us have our vocation. So today I want to title this reflection, The Occupation of Your Vocation. The word occupation means two things, like I've told you, it can be your career, something you do for a living. Then it is also a description of taking possession of a place, isn't it? For instance, you are all occupying the pews here now. You are sitting down, you have taken possession of that place. So, occupation of your vocation means you should take possession of the place or of the mission that God has given to you. All of us have got vocation. Whether you are a priest or a lay person, in addition, apart from your occupation, God has given us all a vocation. Remember, occupation is what you do for a living. Vocation is what you live for. How many of you are living for money? Let me see your hand. That small boy raised his hand. I'm sure your parents are Igbo. And you are from Anambra State. Igbo Queen. And they play. Praise God. All of us here, we have basically the same vocation. We are different occupations. So let me summarize this and end. If you read the Psalm, there are three vocations I say today God is calling us. Number one is the vocation to holiness. We have the vocation to holiness. All of us here, God has called us to be holy. It's our vocation, it's your destiny to be holy. That's why the first thing Jesus told his disciples, or the first thing they did when they went out to preach today, the Bible said they preached repentance. They said, repent. To repent means to change. 1 John chapter 1 verse 15 calls it change of your conduct. Holiness is about changing your conduct. In Mark chapter 1 verse 15, when Jesus began preaching, the first thing he said, repent and believe the gospel, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. To repent means to change. Romans 12, transform your life by the renewing of your mind. Change from being a wife beater. Stop beating your wife, it is wrong. Stop cheating on your wife or your husband, it is wrong. Change, stop gossiping, stop committing fornication and abortion, it is
is wrong. This is the repentance that all of us need. It's when you repent. Repentance means that you lift yourself from the direction of profanity and you place yourself in the path of holiness. Then look at the second reading. Everybody take the bulletin. We didn't start on time, but we are closing now. Have I spoken for up to 10 minutes yet? Carry your bulletins. Let's go to the second reading. Vocation is your destiny. Your destiny means that this is what God intended. Ab initio. Go to the second reading. If you are there, say amen.
Amen.
Are you there? Let us read together. One, two, go. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing. Hold on, hold on. Who has what? With how many blessings? One blessing? Two blessings? Three? How many? Why are some of you still running around looking for one mountain or three to go and get your own blessing? Don't your neighbor say you are already blessed. Yes, now tell your neighbor you are already blessed. You are already blessed. I continue. Even as he chose us in him before that we should be. Hold on. What were you chosen for before the foundation of the world? You should be what? You were chosen to be what? That is your vocation. Before the foundation of the world, before he created the world. To be an engineer started after he created the world. To be a farmer started after he created the world. To be a lawyer started after he created the world. That's why it's an occupation. It is your choice. But your vocation predates you. Your vocation existed before you. Your vocation was chosen by God. He said before the foundation of the world, he chose you to be holy. So there is no such thing that I was an engineer in the mind of God before I came to be. No, you were holy. Help me tell your neighbor, your vocation is holiness. Holiness. You see, that now, whether you are a lawyer or a politician or an engineer or a priest, it doesn't matter. Your vocation is what? Holy. Leviticus 11:44 says, be ye holy, for I, your God, I am holy. Hebrews says, holiness without which no man can see God. Of course, we know the tidbits of holiness. He chose us in Christ, meaning outside Christ, you cannot obtain this holiness. It is what you've given. And I'm telling you, one of the ways to be holy is to repent, to change. Please let me touch your neighbor. Say, change, repent, repent. All of us have got something to repent for. It's unfortunate that in many churches now, nobody talks about holiness because you will offend people. Nobody talks about holiness, you will offend people. Grace does not mean you can live anyhow. Otherwise, okay, then why would God, why would there be judgment on the last day? The grace that some churches teach is the grace that gives you the license to sin as you wish. Okay, if that is it, then why would there be judgment on the last day? He chose us in him before the foundation of the world that we should be holy and what? Blameless before him. So that is our primary vocation, all of us, and that's the reason why Christ came. I'm not teaching about holiness today. I'm telling you what your vocation is. I'm sure one Sunday we come and we teach about holiness, but take this home. Holiness is grace and race. Grace means free gift. He chose us in Christ. That means outside Christ, no matter what you do, you can never be holy. That is grace, gift. But it's also a race. What is a race? Journey. You run. Abby, you compete, isn't it? You stress yourself. You spend yourself, your energy. And that is where this repentance thing comes. Change. Change is not, it's not easy. It's not easy. Nobody wants to change. APC came with change. I read a cartoon then. Who wants Change in Nigeria. Everybody stand. Oh, we want change. Change Mukesu. Okay. Bring your hands down. Who wants to change? All of us want change, Abby. But how many of us want to change? When you see a husband and a wife quarreling, and they come to the point where there is no, where it seems like there is no solution again, this is where the problem is. Both of them want change, but none of them want to change. Or to the wicked level, one expects the other person to change, but does not see the need for himself or herself to change. Change Mukesu. It begins with you. Tell your neighbor, it starts with you. It starts with you. That is repentance. It does not make sense to God that you are in charge of a government parastatal or ministry, and you go and steal millions of naira, billions of naira, and we will invite you to harvest. You give us millions, billions, we will clap for you. But the money you have stolen is the money that would have been used to build roads or schools or pay pension pensioners, and many people are suffering because of that. Let me tell you the truth. The fact that you have donated the money to us does not mean you will not suffer the consequences of what you have done. So if you have that kind of mindset, I'm telling you now, change. Hey, this is a dangerous sermon, especially now that we have not done harvest. God, why am I saying this? Praise God. But that is the truth. You cannot carry millions of naira belonging to pensioners to staff in your office, and then you come and give the church some, and then you feel comfortable that after all the church has. Thanks be to God, we don't even know. I don't know. Change is repentance. Repentance is change. Stop stealing the money of the people and bringing some to the church. It is not true by it. Wave your hand like this. Holiness is our vocation. All of us. All of us. The second vocation today is handy. To be handy. The vocation to be handy. Handy. H-A-N-D-Y. I'm just summarizing it. What does it mean to be handy? To be handy means to be available. Amos was handy. He was not a trained prophet. He did not come from the lineage or from the family of prophets. He had his own occupation when God came to him. But because he was available, God now gave him the ability to carry on the work of a prophet. So one of our vocations is to be handy, means to be available to God. Listen, once you are available to God, don't mind about the ability. If God has called you to a special assignment and you make yourself available, he will provide the ability. You can see it in the gospel. The Bible says Jesus sent his disciples out two by two, and he gave them what? Authority. He gave them the authority. They did not buy it. They did not learn it. It was given to them because they were available for the mission. Once you make yourself available for peace in your family, you'll be surprised at how peace will be restored in that family. I'm sure God is looking for somebody here to go and bring peace in your clan, in the village. You have been scared. How can this be? God is just asking, be available and you will see. Take a move. Isaiah chapter 6. Who shall I send? Who will go for us? Isaiah says, here I am. He was never a prophet. He never learned it. See, once you are available to God, forget about human qualifications. If God calls you, if God gives you a vision, he will give you provision for the vision. If he gives you a mission, he's going to give you the provision for the mission. How many of you are available today? Look around you. There are many missions God wants you to accomplish around your neighborhood. All you need is to be available. Who will go talk to that widow? There is a family there that don't seem to have any friend. They are all looking sad all of the time. But many of you are too busy. You wake up, you drive out in your car. The next time you are driving, but you can see their misery. But you are simply, you don't have the time. You are wondering, if I go 10 minutes now to talk to these people, I may miss one appointment somewhere in the office. And you do this every day, Monday to Friday, January to December. When are you going to be available to at least sit down for 5 minutes and say, what is going on in this family? I don't have time, and you don't have time to. Let us move on. The last one. The vocation to be helpful. Everybody say help, 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 help. All of us have got the vocation to be helpful to everyone. To give help. Psalm 121. I lift my eyes to the mountains. Where shall my help come from? My help shall come from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Psalm 124 verse 8. Our help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. But this help does not fall from heaven straight. It comes through somebody. And that is you. And that is me. You live in this world to be a help. That is the manifest. Well, that is one of the purposes of God's blessing. By saying, I will bless you, and through you, I will bless the nations of the world. To become a blessing. How many people have you helped? How many are you helping? Matthew 25. On the last day. Go and read it. Judgment is not going to be you are a priest. You are a parish priest. It's not going to be based on the sensational sermon I preached as a priest. It's not going to be based on the church I administered. It's not even going to be based on whatever lofty structural and physical development I brought to any church. It is going to be when I was hungry, you gave me food. When I was thirsty, you gave me drink. When I was in prison, you visited me. When I was anxious, you calmed my fear. When I was naked, you clothed me. In other words, when I was a needy person, you gave me help. How many people are you helping? It's your vocation. When Jesus told his apostles, go heal the sick. When you bring healing, what are you doing? You are helping somebody. Cast out the demons. So whatever you do in this life, if it is not helping another person outside of yourself, your closest circle, then there is a question mark. I can't imagine how some of you will be millionaires. Having achieved all these things for years up till now, you are going to the twilight of your years age. You have not helped somebody graduate from school, from an indigent family. Haba. You have business scattered all over the place, and yet nobody who has served you can boast of at least one shop that he can use to feed his family. Are you a ritualist? Eh? Do you know who a witch? You think a witch is someone who flies at night? You know, that's the problem of many of us. We think that witches now are only those who fly at night or drink blood. Listen, if you're a businessman here, successful businessman, you have built your house for long. Your children are in schools, there is no problem. You are living in your posh house and your cars, you have branches. Then we count the people who have served you. All of them, not one person, has survived after 1 year of your settlement because of certain things you have done. You are a witch. You are a witch. You are a witch without wings. Or people serve you after serving you. When it comes to the point of settling them, you bring all kinds of problems so that you don't settle them properly. And they have to start. I say you are a witches and wizards in plural, one person you. And it's as serious as that. Who have you helped? Who is standing on his or her feet today because of your help? That's your vocation. That's my vocation. Because why? 1 Corinthians chapter 12 says we are the body of Christ. We are his hands. and casting crowns, say, if we are his body, why aren't his hands or his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his word teaching? If we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why aren't his love showing them that there is a way? But we are. If we are the body, why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? You know the song. Why? What hand are you giving out to help? There is somebody there whom you can help. Like I said, if all my being a priest does not help anybody, whether through preaching, if this preaching does not help you to change or to learn something that will better your life, I am wasting my time. So all of us have got the vocation to be holy, to be handy, and to be helpful. We've got the vocation to be holy, to be handy, and to be helpful. And that's the decision you need to make today. And God, who has called you, has equipped you, and will continue to equip you so that you will accomplish your vocation in life. In the name of Jesus the Lord. Stand up. I have concluded now. But before I finally conclude, and the gospel says, so they went out and preached that men should repent, and they cast out many demons, and anointed with oil many that were sick and healed them. Because Jesus gave them the authority to say, go, cast out the devils and heal the sick. So I'm praying for you right now. Close your eyes. If you have listened to me, it was after preaching that the apostles healed the sick. I finished preaching to you. I'm sure you have accepted. So I'm praying for you for these two intentions, for healing and for liberty. Lord Jesus, by your wounds we are healed. By the stripes on your body, we are made whole. In Exodus 15:26, Lord, you said, I am the God that healeth thee. There are many of your children with sicknesses and diseases that doctors either have not been able to diagnose or have diagnosed but cannot cure. I pray for them. Even in this month, Lord, by the end of this month, when I say go in peace, the month is ended. The peace of health restored will accompany them home. Amen. I believe, Lord, that by the sacrifice of your body and blood, which we shall reenact in this month, fibroids will go away. Amen. HIV will go away. Amen. Diabetes will go away. And all forms of blood diseases and other sicknesses will leave your children. Amen. Because this is the authority you have given to me, and I'm exercising it on your behalf and on your children. I also pray for liberty. Anyone who is under torment or manipulation by the forces of darkness. 2 Corinthians 3:17 says, where the Spirit of God is, there is freedom. May they receive freedom from every manipulation, every suppression, every oppression in any area of their life, be it in their finances, in their marriages, in their relationships, in their minds, in their emotions, in whichever area of their life they are under any manipulation. Lord, today at the end of this month, they shall go home liberated, emancipated, and delivered. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all